WDAM, Laurel, Hattiesburg.
Hello, I'm Johann Rush. Welcome to this special videotaped presentation of the best of my on-the-road series. Today, I'm going to take you to 18 different locations in counties all over South Mississippi. For our first trip, we're going to Simpson County and the colorful old town of Mendenhall. This is the old dining room in the Revolving Tables restaurant in downtown Mendenhall. This picture was taken in 1937. The restaurant is still in operation and still using the same dining hall. It's now being run by Fred Morgan Jr. and his wife. They are the third generation in the same family to operate this restaurant. In fact, you can see little Fred there on the left in this 1937 photograph. He's sitting alongside his father. And on the right is Fred's grandfather. All three of these people have operated this restaurant over the years. It all began when the Heil Hotel was built in Mendenhall near the railroad station in 1915. It had a boarding house style restaurant inside. This is the way it looked in 1918. By the mid-1920s, it had acquired a second floor balcony, a hedgerow, and a few trees. By the 1930s, it was featured in an issue of National Geographic magazine. The round tables had become more famous than the hotel itself. And so they are today. But actually, it's the fame of the tables that brings new customers in, while it's the fame of the food that brings old customers back. And of course, the food itself is wonderful, or we wouldn't be doing this story. And you can see it in the eyes of the beholders. Not only is the food good, but there's a lot of it. There's fried chicken, and stewed chicken, and green beans. Cabbage, sweet potatoes, meatloaf, black-eyed peas, rice casserole, chicken and dumplings, corn, and jello, turnip greens, squash, okra, and other wonderful dishes. The Revolving Tables is open 7 days a week for dinner and several days a week for supper, but be sure to call ahead to get their latest schedule. That's the Revolving Tables in Mendenhall. To the east of Simpson County is Smith County, and down in the southeastern corner is the town of Taylorsville, where you'll find the Watkins Museum, one of the best historical museums in the state. For many years, this was the location of the historic Taylorsville Signal newspaper from 1901 to 1967. But the old newspaper office has been turned into a fine museum. This building was a store before it became a newspaper office. That's the old Washington Press there on the right. Many of the items in the old store part of the building, mostly on the left there, are still in stock on shelves exactly where they were left right around the turn of the century. Very few items have been brought in from the outside. In this display case, for example, you'll see old starched collars that have never been worn, high top shoes that have never been used, and a bonanza of early turn of the century artifacts. Most of these items were found in the store in 1968. A local garden club decided to turn the store into a museum. That project took about 4 years. It took the garden club so long because this is the way the store looked in 1968. The two ladies who had run the newspaper office for more than 60 years, Hattie and Marie Watkins, never liked to throw anything away. They continued to run the store for a while, even after they started the paper in 1901, but eventually the building became so cluttered they lost all their customers. The newspaper office was closed in 1967 and stayed closed for about a year. Then, members of the garden club in Taylorsville made the discovery of all those antiques. Now, many people all over town, such as J.W. Walker, the town's mayor, pitch in to help keep the museum clean. It's open, by the way, by appointment only, but the mayor's store is right next door. You can contact him at either of these phone numbers to arrange to get inside. Groups are welcome. This old Washington press, by the way, is supposed to be extremely rare. Each page of the newspaper was printed by hand by pulling a large lever on the press. And of course, all the type was set by hand. So were all the old metal cuts or photographs. They were set by hand. Here's an old one of Sonny Montgomery. So, if you'd like to visit an old turn-of-the-century store that hasn't changed much in the past 86 years, go to the Watkins Museum in Taylorsville. But before you go, be sure to call ahead. Call City Hall to get someone to let you in the museum. Nearby in Jasper County, just to the east of Smith County, is the historic old city of Paulding. And you can see the historic sites at Paulding at any time.
Got the cold penitentiary blues, oh boy, I've got the cold penitentiary blues. Thinking of that girl I love, got the cold penitentiary.
In the old pioneer town of Paulding in Jasper County, across the highway from the courthouse, you'll find the old Jasper County Jail. Some people believe it was built before the Civil War. This is what used to be known as a mail order jail. All the cells inside were pre-assembled in St. Louis and shipped into Mississippi by rail and by wagon. The foundation was first put down, then the cells put in place on that foundation, then the building was constructed around the cells. These were very modern jails for their time because the cells were all steel, all the sides, top and bottom. Remember those old cowboy movies where the outlaws got their buddies out of jail by pulling out the window bars with the rope attached to a horse? That actually did happen in old western adobe jails, but these new steel jails eliminated that. The small town jails like this one were pretty harsh on prisoners. 100 years ago, it wasn't uncommon for prisoners to suffer a little bit in those early jails. They were very hot in the summertime and extremely cold in the wintertime. Now, our jails are fine, but many of our public schools are hot in the summertime and cold in the winter. Times sure have changed. When you're in Paulding, be sure to drive around the old town and see some of the other old interesting buildings. The town of Paulding was settled about 1812, and it was an important city in Mississippi until about 1860. In North Clark County, just north of Enterprise, you'll find the entrance to Dunn's Falls, which is actually in Lauderdale County. Dunn's Falls. Irish immigrant John Dunn diverted a creek in the 1850s to create these falls. Then he built a three-story grist mill on this site. The mill tumbled down years ago. But shortly after the Pat Harrison Waterway District acquired this property, they reconstructed Dunn's old mill. Now they have a real water wheel that they brought over here from Georgia, and an old mill house that dates to the 1850s, just like the original one. They actually run this mill and grind corn for the tourists several days a week. The park is open every day except Monday and Tuesday. But in case there's been a schedule change, it's best to call ahead to be sure when they're open now. The old mill house has an interesting story behind it. It looks very much like the one John Dunn built here in the 1850s. But this one was brought from Georgia, board by board. It, too, was originally built in the 1850s. Occasionally at the old mill, they have special attractions, such as this battle between Confederate and Union forces. Union troops did occupy this mill for several months during the Civil War. If you don't mind walking back up, be sure to take the walkway down to the Chunky River. It's easy going down, but quite a climb to come back up. Down at the bottom, you can see the waterfall from many different angles, and you can go swimming and wading in the Chunky River. You can also go swimming in the lake on the top of the hill. This lake was built for the waterfall, because occasionally the waterfall would dry up in the summertime. But with this new lake, it runs all year round. To get to Dunn's Falls, go north on Interstate 59 out of Laurel. Take the North Enterprise exit. That's exit number 137. When you get off the interstate, you'll see signs leading you to Dunn's Falls about 5 miles away. It's off Old Highway 11 on a gravel road. In Lawrence County, in the old pioneer town of Monticello, you will find many old restored homes. We're going to visit now the Longino House. It was the home of a former governor, and it's more than 100 years old. It was completely restored recently by one of the most active historical groups in our area, the Lawrence County Historical Society, based in Monticello. This group has been responsible for the saving of more than 22 historical buildings and homes in Lawrence County. You will note from this restoration that their work is meticulous. For example, Joan Hartzog shows for us here Governor Longino's beaver fur top hat, still in perfect condition, more than 100 years old. And Martha Tynes shows an old painted photograph of the governor that was given to the Historical Society by the family. The Society went to great expense to convert that old painted photograph into an original oil painting of the governor. Martha Tynes also demonstrates her great-grandmother's old spinning wheel, which has been donated to the home's collection. And Joan Hartzog shows the governor's old bookcase and part of his vast book collection. This was donated by the family. All of the furniture in this home was either donated by members of the family or by residents of Lawrence County, especially in the Monticello area. To get inside the Longino home, you need to call either City Hall in Monticello or Joan Hartzog. Just next door in Jeff Davis County, in Bassfield, there's an old home worth seeing. It is abandoned, but it has become somewhat of a local landmark. It was built for John Adam Thaler around 1910, but it was abandoned by his family in the early 1950s, and it's been gradually disintegrating for the past 40 years. There are two unique features about the house. First, all four sides look exactly alike. Each side looks like the front of the house. The second unusual feature, the house is made mostly out of concrete cinder blocks that were made right here by hand on the site. To find the house, go east on the main downtown street in Bassfield. It's about a mile from downtown on the right. Not too many miles away, south of Bassfield, is the old Wilkes home. The first part of the building was constructed in the late 1700s. The main part of the building was built in 1842. It's on private property, but you can drive down the highway and take a look at it. This is probably the oldest house still standing in Jeff Davis County. To get to it, go southeast out of Bassfield on Highway 42. Take the first paved road to the right just after you leave the city limits. The home and the family cemetery are about 4 miles away. One of the most popular places to visit in Covington County, just south of Seminary, is Asa Bryant's blueberry farm. He also raises miniature horses. They look quite a bit like regular or full-size horses, except, of course, they're much smaller.
We bought our first miniatures in May of 85.
How many do you have now?
We have 75 now. We've had 14 babies so far this year.
Are you going to keep expanding?
We probably won't get any more than what we've got right now, but we'll sell some of these and buy a better quality and be constantly upgrading the quality of them.
What do they sell for?
Pet quality ones sell for $500 to $1,000, and they sell on up to $50,000 or $100,000. There's been two little stallions that sold for over $125,000 each.
Is this profitable at this point, or is it just still a hobby?
We're going into it for a profit, but we haven't sold but just two or three yet. We are planning on selling some this summer and fall.
How many farms are there like this around the entire country?
There's probably 300 or so breeders. Most people have, there's a lot of people that just have 12 to 14. Some have 200 or 300.
And you said they're a lot more gentle than full-size horses?
Most of them are. They're a lot like a dog. They're real good pets. They're real friendly, and they like affection. And children are good with them, and they're good with children.
Why don't you describe some of the ones we went out and caught and played with out there?
Okay. The smallest little filly that we caught is a little 19-inch. She was 19 inches when she was born. She's about 6 weeks old now and hadn't grown much since she's been was born. She'll probably mature out at about 30 inches, which will be real good. They can't be more than 34 inches tall, and the smaller the better. Then Sugar, the friendliest one we looked at, is just like a real house pet. She'll nuzzle you and carry off your tools when you're working, try to get things out of your pocket. She's just a real friendly little horse.
And this stallion, is this your prize horse here?
Mucho Dinero is our Pinto Stallion. He's the nicest one we've got, but then he probably compares equally with Explosion, the Appaloosa Stallion that you looked at there. We're real proud of both of them.
Now, how would some of these horses be as pets, let's say in a yard, a fenced-in yard that's too small to have a full-sized horse, but might be able to handle one of these?
They'd be ideal. You could keep them in your backyard. They don't eat much. They eat just a little bit of hay and about a third of a coffee can of feed a day, pelletized feed.
And they would graze on the grass, too?
Right. They'd mow your lawn and fertilize it at the same time if you want them to.
At this farm, you can pick blackberries and blueberries during May, June, and July. And you can see the horses all year around. To see the miniature horses, go to Bryland Blueberry Farms, just south of Seminary, just west of Highway 49. You'll be turning west at Poor Boys Truck Stop. In Jones County, in the city of Laurel, you can find the best art museum in Mississippi. It's been here since the 1920s. There's no admission charge, and you don't have to know a thing about art to enjoy this museum. They have hundreds of beautiful paintings on display, and some of the gallery rooms are also decorated. The museum was built in the 1920s by the grandfather of a young man who was named Lauren Rogers. He died in 1921. He was a fairly wealthy young man, and money from his estate financed the Lauren Rogers Museum. It also paid for the purchase of all these fine paintings and helps to support the museum to this very day. In addition to the paintings, the museum also has on permanent display a collection of fine silver, mostly sterling. Many of these silver items are handmade and they date back a couple of hundred years. In addition to the sterling, the museum also has on display a fine collection of early American Indian baskets. These were collected around the turn of the century, and many of them represent designs that have been discontinued. Most of the baskets come from Western Indians, from Utah, New Mexico, Arizona, and California. However, a few Mississippi Choctaw baskets are represented here. Every year or so, the Lauren Rogers Museum rotates its exhibits. There are many other baskets and paintings in storage in the basement, so you can actually go year after year and see different works of art. Also, several times during the year, the museum brings traveling art shows to town, such as this collection painted by Leon Jerome Ferris around the turn of the century. He specialized in patriotic art. You may have seen some of these paintings before, or at least copies of them, framed and on the wall of old schoolhouses. Well, these are the originals, worth hundreds of thousands of dollars apiece. Many of these paintings were on display at the Smithsonian Institution in Washington for years. There are many different ways you can look at this display at the Lauren Rogers. First, of course, for their historical value, then perhaps for their style. The style is quite similar to that taken up by Norman Rockwell about 20 or 30 years later. On one hand, you can say these paintings are quite realistic, while other art critics might say that they're too idealistic, showing a fanciful side of life that never existed. You can look at the paintings as a group, or you can zoom in closer and closer and closer to see the detail. Then you can scan even closer to see individual faces, and you can imagine what stories go with those faces. And of course, it's fun at an exhibit of real paintings like this to go all the way in, to see how the paint was actually put on the canvas. This traveling exhibit has moved on now, but there will be others at the Lauren Rogers Museum. They're open every day except Monday, on the corner of 5th Avenue and 7th Street in Laurel. We go now to Wayne County, just outside the town of Waynesboro, on Highway 84 West. Sam Sanderson has built himself a very unusual home and a complete pioneer village. The center of the village is a large log cabin that Sam built. Sam actually lives here. He also built several other log buildings and is in the process of building more. Sam Sanderson collects early American pioneer tools and early farm equipment. A lot of the farm equipment has been donated to Sam by friends who knew that he collected this type of material. Some of the items are rather large, including farm wagons and buckboards. He even collects early American farm animals. He bought these young oxen for $500. This type of farm animal was quite common in Mississippi 125 years ago. In fact, this very scene could have been taken in the 1860s.
And the honey in the comb, and the golden sunbeam bend to kiss the dew.
Right in front of his log cabin on his property is a small lake. This lake is unusual in that it is filled with mineral water that comes from a natural artesian well. He says he dug the well 2 years ago, and it's been flowing like this ever since. In such an idyllic setting, it's easy to understand that when Sam's not busy at work, and when he's not busy constructing new buildings on his property, he likes to just sit around on his front porch and rock. Sam doesn't have a telephone and no official hours, but he said he's usually here every day after 3 o'clock and generally here every Saturday and Sunday. The cabin is very reminiscent of pioneer life in Mississippi, and as we go inside and see how Sam lives, it's like going back in time. Sam has all the modern conveniences he needs, electric lights, a stove, a refrigerator, a coffee pot. But everything else, the furniture, the decorations, the wall hangings, the mementos, they're all from a time gone by.
She's long gone, and now I'm lonesome blue.
Sam is also a collector of artifacts, especially old farm equipment. If you go by Sam's place when he's there, especially in the summertime, he's likely to show you how some of this equipment works.
This is a two-hopper, one-row seed planter. This instrument is a corn sheller that was used commercial years ago at a grist mill.
Sam's place is located on a dirt road about a half a mile north of Highway 84 at Waynesboro. You turn north about 1 mile east of the Chickasahay River Bridge. To find the old China Grove Methodist Church in Walthall County, go northeast of Tylertown on Highway 585. It's about 5 miles north of 98. This church was organized in 1836, and this building was constructed in 1854. It's in such good condition, it's difficult to believe that it's 134 years old. For some reason, the main doors slide into the walls rather than opening on hinges. And right inside is a wall on which the name of every minister who ever preached here is listed, going from 1836 right up to the present day. The Methodists bought this location from a group of Baptists in 1836, and they used a log cabin church until this new building was constructed. It took them 7 years to build this new building, which is probably why it has lasted so long. With the coming of the Depression in the 1930s, many rural church members had to move into Tylertown to get jobs. Church attendance fell off quite a bit until about 1944, when it began to pick up again. Back in the 1880s, revival meetings were held here in the form of old-fashioned camp meetings. In 1880, as many as 21 camping tents were counted out in the lawn surrounding the church, all filled with families from all over South Mississippi. Located nearby is the China Grove Methodist Cemetery, and it too is just as old as the church. To get there, go on Highway 585 in Walthall County, about 5 miles north of Highway 98. The church will be on the right. Just a few miles away in Marion County, west of Columbia on Highway 98, right at Foxworth, you'll find the best barbecue restaurant in South Mississippi. It's Letha's Restaurant, and Letha is becoming well known around the nation because of all the businessmen who are brought here when they do business in South Mississippi. Letha supervises all the cooking of the beef and the pork. She says sometimes she gets up as early as 5 o'clock in the morning to get ready for the crowd that will come in the evening. This metal cooker is a little unusual. She bought it many years ago, and some people say it is the secret to her good barbecue. Hickory logs are burned here in this firebox. The hot smoke goes through these stovepipes into the main cooking chamber. The meat is cooked over several hours. We talked to Letha about how she started her business.
Well, I started in my kitchen, in my home. And I started on a little stove, on zinc, and a counter. I didn't even have a table in there.
Is that right? What did you use for the actual dining room?
I didn't use no dining room, but a cure out.
Carry out, I see.
I just had carry out and cook for the public.
She built a large dining room several years ago to handle the crowds. The restaurant is usually open Thursday, Friday, and Saturday evenings, but be sure to call ahead to see if there has been a schedule change. Letha's Restaurant has been written up in several newspapers and magazines. Her place is a little difficult to find, so listen carefully. Go west out of Columbia on Highway 98. Cross the Pearl River and look for this gas station on the right. Then you'll take the third paved road to the right. First, you'll go over this bridge over a railroad track. Then you'll see that third paved road to the right. Turn right there. Then take the next right and the next left, and you'll be on the way to Letha's. It's about a half a mile ahead. In Lamar County, way down south, near the town of Lumberton, you'll find one of the biggest pecan plantations in the world. We're in one of the orchards of the Bass Pecan Company near Lumberton. We're going to show you now the three stages of harvesting pecans commercially. First, this $50,000 tree vibrator goes into the field in late fall. It grips the tree and then shakes it, causing most of the pecans to fall on the ground. After this, a sweeper goes into the field and sweeps all the debris into a neat long row in between the rows of trees. Behind the sweeper comes a vacuum machine. This vacuums up all the leaves and pecans. The leaves are blown out to the side and the pecans wind up in the hopper. From here, they're taken to a processing plant where they're sorted, cleaned, and packaged for shipping. These are Stewart pecans, the most common type. But David Huff holds up a display of many different types of pecans. Some are giants. Some have thin shells. Some are sweet. But the Stewart does the best in all types of growing conditions. So says Dr. Sam Polis, one of the new owners of Bass Pecans. Their store is open for the sale of pecans throughout November and December. They sell trees January, February, and March. To find the store, go about 5 miles north of Lumberton on Highway 11 and look for the sign. In Forest County, south of Hattiesburg, you can go visit the 7J's Bird and Animal Farm. This is probably the largest private zoo in the state of Mississippi. It started out as a small backyard hobby for Betty Jones and her husband.
What is it?
A spotted Indian leopard.
He'll be 3 years old in June. And he was raised in my house. Huh. Hello, sweetheart. Hello. Yes. Yes. Oh, yes. You're just showing off, aren't you? Yes, you are. You want to give me a hug? Come on and give me a hug. Come on. Come on, give me a hug. Oh, yes. Oh, hug me tight. Yeah, well, hug me good. Come on. Yeah.
The hobby began with just a few exotic birds out behind the Jones house in a pen, like this rare white peacock. Over the years, more birds and then a few animals were added to the collection. The largest bird on the farm is this rhea from South America. They are very similar to the ostrich. The one in the background is called an emu.
This guy is so old, I really don't think he can even hear very well. I think he's about half blind, half deaf.
Well, I know how he feels. This is a colorful Lady Amherst pheasant from the Seven Jays Bird Farm. The farm has many varieties of very colorful birds. This is an Indian blue peacock. This is the standard type seen in most zoos around the country. And this is a silky chicken, a rooster. Silkies come from China. And this is a yellow golden pheasant. The bird farm is usually open every day of the week, Monday through Saturday from 10 a.m. until sunset, and on Sunday from noon until sunset. We're going inside Betty Jones' home now to talk to Chico.
Hello!
Like most parrots, Chico is camera shy.
You're a
but we did trick him a little bit and get him to talk on camera.
We'll knock again and let me try it with me.
Okay. Come on in.
Now, what is your name?
Hello.
What is your
Come
name?
Come on in.
Yeah, we're in. What is your name? Get him up.
Pico.
That's it. That's it. Okay.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, Pico. Bye.
Now he waves good.
Seven Jays is located south of Hattiesburg, just off of Highway 49. Go to the Camp Shelby Southgate sign, then turn west. You'll be going away from Camp Shelby about 2 miles. You'll see another sign on the right. Next to Forest County is Perry County, and in the center is New Augusta. This is what's known as the new Perry County Courthouse in New Augusta, even though it was built in 1904. The old courthouse was across the Leaf River in Old Augusta. Back there on the left is the old county jail. It was also built in 1904. Here's a close-up view. The old jail was used about 50 years, and then for the next 30 or 40 years, it was just left standing and began to deteriorate. Here's a picture taken on opening day. Just this past year, a group of men and women with the Perry County Historical Society decided to take on the project of restoring this classic old jail. And this is the way it looks today. Just about as good as new. And this is Earl Cousins and Gene Watkins. They did much of the restoration work themselves, including the refinishing of most of the old furniture now on display on the inside of the jail. This desk, for example, is about 150 years old, and it came from the old Augusta courthouse. It's handmade, and it was put together with pegs rather than nails or screws. And here's an old rope bed. Notice the pegs holding the ropes together. This bed is also on display in the museum. Of course, a fancy bed like this was never actually in use in the jail, but many Perry County residents have donated artifacts to put on display here, such as these old typewriters. This is an Oliver from 1912. Hit the keys on this one, and the type hammers come straight down. The old cells are still here, and inside, the cotton mattresses have been restored. There are a few other artifacts inside the cells that have been donated to the Historical Society. Outside, you can see how the old locking system worked. Instead of having a lock on the door, the jailer pulled this lever, and that caused a metal flange to seal the door tight. That way, the criminal couldn't get at the lock to pick it. Also in the old jail, the potbelly stove that used to heat the whole building. And above that, a drawing of the old jail done by a prisoner in the new jail looking out the window. He did this on a bed sheet, and he had enough spare time to draw in every individual brick. In the office portion of the jail, there are other artifacts that have been donated, such as this old electric stove that still works, and take a look at this handmade push broom. The old jail is open only by appointment, which you can make by calling Wilmer Dennis or the Sheriff's Office in New Augusta. In Greene County, in the DeSoto National Forest, is the Turkey Fork Recreational Area. This is a national park, a federal park, not a state park. This is one of the least known and least crowded of all the campground parks in Mississippi. The most prominent feature is the large and beautiful lake, suitable for fishing, water skiing, and swimming. The lake is open all year for boating and fishing. Skiing is allowed from noon until sundown on Wednesdays, Thursdays, Saturdays, and Sundays. Overnight camping is allowed only in the spring and summer, from April 1st till just after Labor Day, which is the first week in September. Actually, the Turkey Fork Recreational Area is fairly new and not too many people know about it. It was built by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. It has hiking trails, a small garden area, indoor restrooms, and a covered shelter or pavilion for larger picnics. The pavilion can be reserved ahead of time. Of course, the fact that the place is not very well known and generally deserted means that you won't find a crowd there when you go. To get there, go east out of Richton on Highway 63, or go northwest out of Leakesville on Highway 63. There will be big signs on the highway telling you where to turn. Our next story actually covers two counties. First, we start in Pearl River County, just a little south of Picayune. Watch for the signs for the John C. Stennis Space Center. It's open 9 to 5 every day. You'll start in Pearl River County and end up in Hancock County at the Visitor Center. Be sure to call ahead if you have a group of 10 or more. The observation tower lets you look out over the entire NASA site. Inside the building is a fine space technology museum, filled with a space capsule and other rocket parts that have actually been used. The museum reminds us of a World's Fair display, except that this one is permanent. This hard-shell spacesuit is actually for use underwater. Another display shows how mortar shells are manufactured at the ammunition plant located nearby. They also have on display satellite photographs taken from hundreds of miles in the air. Let's look at this view of Gulfport, for example. We can keep zooming in almost indefinitely until we can actually see cars on highways and people in their backyards. But one of the most interesting displays are the pictures of the three astronauts who were born right here in Mississippi. There's Richard Truly from Fayette, Fred Hayes from Biloxi, and Donald Peterson from Winona. Fred Hayes wore this spacesuit when he went to the moon. It's amazing, but true. The three onboard engines of every space shuttle flight have been thoroughly tested in South Mississippi by residents who live in Poplarville and Picayune and other small South Mississippi communities. Those three engines there were trucked into Mississippi, where they were put on large test platforms and checked out thoroughly. The space shuttle on liftoff has five engines going. Those two big ones are solid fuel rockets, and they're tested in Utah. But the three little ones shown on the right are tested in Mississippi on this gigantic platform just south of Picayune. There are a total of three platforms used for different types of testing. Here's what an engine test looks like.
Engine start.
After a certain number of shuttle flights, the engines are carefully removed, trucked back into Mississippi, and tested again. If the test checks out okay, they're taken back by truck to Cape Canaveral where they're reinstalled in a space shuttle and they go up into space again. In Stone County, just north of Wiggins on Highway 29, is the state's only commercial alligator farm. Duncan Hatton has more than 200 alligators in the woods behind his store. Many of them are small, like this, but others are fairly large, like this. Mr. Hatton says that in cool weather, alligators slow down because they're cold-blooded. They don't start getting really active until the heat of the summer.
We have approximately 200 alligators here on the farm.
How long ago did you start this project?
We've been here about 10 or 11 years now.
And how many did you start with?
Well, we started with probably 140 or so. We've raised about 50 or 60 over the years.
Are they expensive to buy?
Alligators are expensive to buy, especially for brood stock. Whenever you're first getting into it, they're kind of expensive.
How much would one cost?
They vary. If you can buy one just for hide value, what their hide would cost. Of course, a couple of years ago, the skins were worth up to about $28 a foot. And then this last year, they were down $11 or $12 a foot. So if you can buy them for the price of the skins, then they're not too bad.
How old is that big one out there?
The oldest alligator that we have here is estimated to be between 150 and 175 years old.
That means that the oldest alligator on the farm could have been hatched as long ago as 1811. To get to the alligator farm, simply go to the Flint Creek Water Park on Highway 29 north of Wiggins, and there you'll see the cabin store and the alligator farm. It's usually open 7 days a week. In George County, north of Loosedale, off Highway 98, you'll find an interesting place called Palestinian Gardens. This is a very unusual private park open to the public. It contains a miniature replica of the Holy Land as described in the New Testament of the Bible.
If you made a trip to the Holy Land today and saw the modern Jericho that's standing over there now, it'd be about in the location of our sign. We didn't bother trying to reconstruct that city because it don't have anything to do with the Bible. It was all built since Bible times. But then back here is what we call New Testament Jericho. Now, that's where Jericho was located in the early New Testament times. That's the city that Jesus visited there. Now, if we were over in the Holy Land, we'd be out in desert country now. This would be part of the Arabian desert. And this is where Jesus laid out the parable of the Good Samaritan. You know, he said the man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho, and he really was, because it's quite a drop. Now, here's Bethlehem, the inn, symbolic of where there was no room for Mary and Joseph, and the stable where the manger was. You know, here in Mississippi, we think about keeping stock in a barn out behind the house, but it wasn't like that over there. Wood was scarce, so they didn't build barns, but caves were everywhere, and the manger was in a cave. There, Jerusalem, about the way it looked in the early New Testament times. Of course, there was a temple standing there then, and that was a temple that old Herod the Great had built. And when Jesus was just a baby, they took him to the temple, and Joseph offered a sacrifice of two turtle doves, which tells you something about Joseph right away. He's a very poor man, because in Leviticus it says, if you don't have money for the lamb or the ram or the bullock, you can offer birds as a sacrifice.
James Kirkpatrick has been our tour guide today. This private park is open in the spring and the summer from May 1st till the end of September. Then it's open every day of the week from 8 a.m. till 3 p.m. It's located 6 miles north of Loosedale, just off Highway 98. You'll see the signs.
Well, there you have it. 18 locations from all over South Mississippi.
Before you go to any of these locations, be sure to call ahead to see if they're going to be open. You might want to check on prices also.
I'm Johann Rush. Thank you for watching.